Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome His Excellency Li Keqiang, Premier of the People's Republic of China.
Welcome, everyone, to the 456th meeting of the Economic Club of New York. This is our 100th and 9th year in existence. I'm Terry Lundgren, Chairman of the Economic Club and Chairman and CEO of Macy's Incorporated. The Economic Club in New York is the nation's leading nonpartisan forum of speeches on economic, social, and political issues. More than 1,000 guests have spoken at our club sessions over the last century, and we have established a very strong existence of excellence. I want to personally recognize the 234 members of the Centennial Society. These club members continue to do extraordinary work and make great contributions to ensure the financial stability of the club into our second century. I'd also like to welcome the students who are here from Columbia University School of International and Public Affairs. And they are here in attendance with us. And whenever possible, we like to invite our high-performing students to expose them to the activities of the Economic Club. This evening, the Economic Club of New York, joined by the U.S.-China Business Council, the National Committee on United States and China Relations, are honored to be able to welcome our distinguished guest, His Excellency Li Keqiang, the Premier of the People's Republic of China. We have headsets, by the way, and on your tables if you would like to use them to assist you in translations. The introduction of the Premier this evening will be done by none other than an Economic Club member, Chairman of Kissinger Associates, Dr. Henry Kissinger. Dr. Kissinger, please come to the podium.
Premier Li Keqiang, members of the Economic Club of New York and the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations, it is a great honor to welcome Premier Li Keqiang, with whom I've had the privilege of having many conversations over the years. A lifetime ago, in 1971, Premier Zhou Enlai, meeting for the first time in Beijing to end a quarter century of broken contacts. Zhou Enlai began by telling me that China was not a mysterious country to the billion Chinese who lived there. Presumably, neither would I if I made an effort to get to know China. Since then, over the course of four decades, I have witnessed three dramatic revolutions in China. Mao's, which restored unity and dignity. Deng's, which brought reform. And now the revolution of President Xi Jinping, which seeks simultaneously to renew a party of 87 million members, restructure an economy of 1.3 billion, and advance a new vision of foreign policy for the world. When asked about the prospect of success of such vast undertakings, I say that over these decades, I have witnessed many extraordinary, seemingly unbelievable efforts in China. doubters do not take into account the determination of the Chinese people and the vision of its leadership. So today, 40 years later, theorists speculate about the impact on geopolitics when China's GDP equals or perhaps exceeds that of the United States. Premier Li, you have helped guide the most recent years of China's progress, not only as Premier and Vice Premier, but as the head of major provinces, Liaoning and Henan. As Premier, you have challenged your country to undertake macroeconomic reform, to redistribute wealth, and move the Chinese economy from reliance on manufacturing and export to one based on technology and consumption, emphasizing innovation to both nurture new sectors and remodel old ones. You have called for a hybrid driving force of growth. As these efforts gain momentum, the United States and China will become the world's two most consequential countries, not only economically, but geopolitically. This reality and the heretofore inconceivable reach and destructiveness of modern technology impose on our two countries an obligation which has been recognized by both leaders to avoid conflict and to define common purposes. In pursuit of these goals, both countries are challenged to some extent by their histories. We both conceive of ourselves as exceptional, but in markedly different way. The United States believes its values are universal and should be spread to other countries around the world to a kind of missionary effort. China acts on the assumption that its values are culturally unique. It strives to have an impact by example so that its performance will cause other countries to turn to Beijing. The task before us then is to enable these two concepts of nationhood to coexist peacefully and cooperatively. In this effort, it is essential that in regions where the US and China interact directly, no effort will be spared to diffuse crisis and to seek cooperative solutions as in Korea. And on the constructive side, the One Belt, One Road initiative, which you, Premier Li, have been so instrumental in putting forward, is historic both in scope and in impact. A way should be found for the United States to participate in some of its project. Mr. Premier, I'm confident that your first visit to the United States as Premier will make a significant contribution to the relationship of our two countries and to the peace of the world. On behalf of the Economic Club, the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations, and the U.S.-China Business Council, and on my behalf, I welcome you to New York and to the States. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to introduce to you Premier Li Keqiang.
I have been rendered warm hospitality, and I appreciate the invitation for me to attend this event. Before I entered this room, I had a brief conversation with Dr. Kissinger. I asked him, well, 45 years ago, on your plane to China on this secret visit, what's on your mind? He didn't say much. He didn't share with me any of his secret thoughts. He just told me that that time China-US trade was almost zero, or even less than what was traded between the United States and a small country in Central America. Well, at that time, he might be predicting that 40 years later, 45 years later, China-US trade will take up one-fifth of the world's total trade. And combined, our two economies will take up one-third of the world's total 45 years ago, 45 years later. Well, that's the magic of change. That's how much has changed. But sometimes a man proposes, but God disposes. Because in 2008, the global financial crisis broke out. Back then, world trade was almost collapsed. Well, but 8 years later, today, world trade is still sluggish, and there have been a series of challenges. Well, today, I attended a meeting on the large movement of refugees and migrants at the United Nations. And in many parts of the world, we see terrorist attacks. Although we still cannot confirm the nature of what has been happening around the world, but people worry. Well, just a day before I departed for the United States, there was this explosion right here in New York. We all live in the same planet Earth, and no one can stay immune. The geopolitical conflict has kept propping up. Just now, Dr. Kissinger asked, when China's economy equals that of the United States, what kind of political, geopolitical changes there will be? Now let me address that question. Even if China's economy is on par with that of the United States, the United States is the largest developed country in the world, and China is the largest developing country in the world, and that reality has not changed. There is still a long way to go for China in its modernization drive. Well, size is important, but per capita figure is more important. Now for the United States, the per capita GDP is seven times that of China's per capita GDP. For China to reach the level of a middle-income country, Well, our goal is that it will happen by the mid of this century. Now, as things stand, people are seeing that China's economy is growing rapidly, and at the same time, people also have questions. It seems that China's economy is slowing down, and will that create problems? Indeed, we need to answer this question from two perspectives, and that is not easy. What I'm trying to say today is that as the world economy is had this slow recovery, as the world trade is declining in growth, well, last year world trade was down by 13%. Well, China, its economy is so closely integrated with that of the world economy, we still maintain steady growth of our economy. But there is a change, or something has changed. The growth rate has slowed down. And there are many reasons. One important reason is that in 2014, China's economy in size reached $10 trillion. Well, around the world, economies above $2 or $3 trillion, if they keep growing by double-digit growth rate, there is no precedent. It is never seen. But for China, for the past 3 to 4 years, our growth rate has been kept at above 6.5%. Well, this year, in the first 6 months, our economy grew by 6.7%. Well, that rate, well, 5 years ago or 10 years ago to China means an increment generated by double-digit growth rate, because that means every year the increment will be 800 billion US dollars, equivalent to the economy of a medium-sized economy. We will maintain such a medium high growth rate. People may ask, as a major economy, China has been one of the top in terms of growth rate. Why do you still want to sustain such a medium high growth rate? That is because in China we have 1.3 billion people. Every year, there are 13 million or 14 million people need new jobs in urban areas. And we have, according to our standard, 50 million people living in poverty. So in China, we need to keep developing, and in that process, create jobs, or sufficient jobs. We need to mobilize our national resources to fight poverty. I can say here that in the third quarter of this year or till the end of this year, China's economy will maintain this momentum of a steady growth, as we saw in the first half of this year. For the past 3 years, every year we create 13 million new urban jobs, and this year, from January to August, we created 9.5 million new urban jobs. Talking about new urban jobs, maybe some people will say, what does that mean to the United States? Would that mean that there will be implications for jobs in the United States? Well, look at China-U.S. trade figures. You will find that Chinese investment to the United States and China's import of industrial goods, agricultural produce from the United States have created millions of jobs for the United States, inside the United States. If China's economy cannot sustain such a growth rate, to be honest, that will have negative implications to the United States, to the U.S. jobs. And vice versa, if the U.S. economy is not doing well as the largest economy in the world, it is bad news for China as well. So we are interdependent. Just now in his remarks, Dr. Kissinger said that China's economy is in the process of transformation and upgrading. How can we still sustain this medium-high growth rate? That is because we are going for restructuring of China's economy. On the one hand, we are transforming and upgrading traditional industries, including outphasing outdated production capacities. And at the same time, we are fostering new drivers, new dynamisms. The new drivers generate enormous hope, whether in rural China or cities. If you have the chance, go to China and you will see that new business types, new industries, and new technologies are mushrooming day by day. With a mobile phone, some people can provide the services for people living in northern part of China to have a holiday in the southern part of China in winter. And they can provide low-price housing services in the real estate sector to those holiday makers. And in rural areas, the agricultural produce, the farmers sometimes find it hard to sell what they produce. But if they go online, you don't have to set up a counter by the field. For example, 2 yuan of orange, if you go online, 5 yuan per half a kilogram. So these are the new drivers emerging. And still, we don't have the full picture. This is just a few examples. These new dynamisms and new driving forces are transforming our traditional industries. And our traditional industries combined with new driving forces are being elevated to higher levels. China's economic structure is undergoing this huge changes. Now the sector, the service sector, its contribution to GDP has exceeded 60%. Well, for the past 2 years, the growth rate has been 4 to 5 percentage points. And the momentum continues to sustain. Why could we achieve such a growth? And why do we think that we can keep this continued and steady growth? In the fundamental way, it is because of reform and opening up. Reform and opening up has carried China this far for the past 3 decades, and going forward, we still need to rely on reform and opening up to go further. Just now I mentioned the new drivers and new dynamisms, and they create a lot of employment opportunities. We're also working to streamline our administration while strengthening regulation. On the one hand, we are relaxing the administration over the entrepreneurs when they want to start up their business. At the same time, the government provides a service platform so that the businesses can compete with each other on this level playing field. And we also reform the business registration sector and administration approval system. We want to promote a mass entrepreneurship and innovation. Every day, there are 15,000 new businesses get registered. And last year, that figure was 14,000. Before these reforms were started, the newly registered businesses grew by about 2 times compared with previous years. China has 1.3 billion people. 170 million people have received higher education or have special skills, and that is rarely seen in other parts of the world. So we have a huge reservoir of human capital. If we can bring market potential to full play, if we can unleash all the creativities in the society, what can be achieved is a lot. And there are huge choices and options for consumers. Well, in China, we say that three ordinary people can outsmart a best strategist, and three persons working together, there is a teacher that can teach me something. Well, three, the figure three can mean limitless numbers. Confucius say that one gives birth to two, two gives birth to three, and three generates the world. So three means the massive general public. Well, people are now innovating, and they are the players directly involved in the market. So if their creativity can be brought into full play, how much can be achieved?
At the same time, we're also advancing opening up, and in recent years, the Chinese government has abolished 40% of the items that previously require administrative approval, and also the items that require approval for foreign investment or the items which are restricted for foreign investment have been slashed by half. And I often receive a letter from foreign companies and investors. They complain about the business environment in China. But on the other hand, I also often receive reports from U.S.-China Business Council. According to their analysis, in last year, over 90% of American companies are making profits in China. And in the first half of this year, U.S. investment in China has grown by 1.2-folds. And when there was no trade between China and the United States, there was no trade complaints, there was no trade disputes, and there was not even a direct flight between our two countries. So President Dr. Kissinger had to come to China on a plane of a third country. And now we have such a big trade volume and such big mutual investment. So it is inevitable that we may have trade frictions and differences. But these frictions and differences are not the mainstream. They only account for a very small part of our cooperation. But of course, we cannot turn a blind eye to these very small part of frictions. We need to expand our common ground and our common interests while properly resolving our differences. China has made enormous economic and social progress over the past 3 decades and more, and it is attributable to a peaceful international environment and a stable neighborhood environment. And so while pursuing reform and opening up, China will also be firm in following the path of peaceful development. As I said earlier, China is a developing country. We have 1.3 billion people. The central and the western regions are still lagging far behind eastern regions, and there is even a bigger gap between the urban and the rural areas. If China can manage its own affairs well, if China can achieve modernization, it will be a huge contribution to the world in itself. And we are maintaining stable growth rate. Our contribution rate to the world economy is now 30%. China and the United States combined, our contribution to world economic growth is over 50%. China is willing to uphold the international order that was established after the Second World War. And at the general debate of the UNGA, I will reaffirm China's position. That is, we uphold the sanctity of the UN Charter. We uphold the authority of the United Nations in coordinating international affairs. And of course, the international system and the international governance system need to be improved. China, as a developing country, hopes that there will be greater voice of developing countries in the international governance system. And we also hope to promote inclusive economic growth and balanced economic and social progress. In international relations, countries, big or small, need to work together. They need to respect each other, treat each other as equals, and jointly uphold a world of harmony. China and the United States may differ in national circumstances and cultural backgrounds, but we are willing to promote mutual respect and a win-win cooperation with the United States. China believes in cultural diversity, and we maintain that cultural exchanges and mutual learning are important. We believe that all countries and all nations have their own civilization that they are proud of. So China will be a constructive player in international relations. We also believe that in its course of modernization, we need to learn advanced technology and managerial expertise of foreign countries. We need to form a mutually beneficial and a win-win relationship with the United States, the largest developed country in the world. I believe that this is a strategic policy we will follow in the following decades. Even China becomes a modern developed country at a medium level, we will never forget the teaching of our ancestors, that is, we should not do unto others things we do not want to do unto ourselves. We will continue to follow the path of peaceful development. Thank you.
Thank you, Premier Li, for your words, and Dr. Kissinger for your informed introduction. The rest of the program will be consecutively translated, so you'll no longer need your headsets. And as is the tradition of the club, we will now introduce our questioners, all members of the Economic Club, and at the request of Premier Li, there will be four questioners this evening. They will include William Berkeley, Chairman and CEO of W.R. Berkeley Corporation, Thomas Farley, President of New York Stock Exchange, Susie Garib, Senior Special Correspondent for Fortune, and Robert Hormats, Vice Chairman of Kissinger and Associates. We will go in alphabetical order, so Mr. Berkeley, you have the first question.
Premier, as China has become more and more of a global power and seeks to do business around the world, it's important that its markets become open to competitors from around the world. How do you see that evolving? And how do you see the markets in China becoming more open?
总理先生，我的问题是这样的：随着更多的中国企业走出去，在世界各地的市场开展投资和经营活动，我们也期待中国的市场能够进一步开放，吸引来自外国的经商者。您对此怎么看？您对中国市场进一步开放有什么看法？
中国在对外开放的初期，我们是注重叫做引进来，就是吸引外资。中国发展到今天，我们发现，在全球化的背景下，我们需要跟跨国公司合作。中国的企业本身也要国际化，所以我们现在叫做 引进来和走出去并重，但是对中国这样一个发展中国家来说，我们仍然需要大量的外资进入。这不仅仅是我们需要资金，的确，它对中国经济有推动作用。比如现在在中国， 我们实际利用外资已经累计达到1.7万亿美金，又变换了方式，不是同船了，要交船是吧？对。所以我停顿一下，你们也可以吃一口饭。Well,
as this is a consecutive interpreting, maybe I'll take a pause for you to have some time to have some food. In the early days of China's opening up, we put most of the emphasis on bringing in foreign investment. But for China's economy to come to where it is today, in the age of globalization, now we are making great efforts to work with multinationals, and Chinese companies are also finding more opportunities to invest overseas. So nowadays, we are giving equal emphasis to bringing in foreign investors and for Chinese companies to go global. We are attracting foreign investment not just for the sake of capital. It's true that the capital has been essential in boosting China's economy, but this is not the sole purpose. As you may know, currently the total paid in foreign investment made in China has reached $1.7 trillion.
中国已经24年连续成为 外资直接投资最大的发展中国家，我们现在依然想使中国成为外资投入的热土。这不仅仅是刚才我说的，我们需要外资推动的力量，我们更需要外资带来的新的管理理念、先进的技术。当然，我要明确， 我们在技术方面的合作是没有先决条件的，我们不会强迫外资到中国必须转让他们的技术。For
24 years in a row, China has been the largest recipient of foreign direct investment among all the developing countries. And going forward, we hope that China will remain one of the most attractive destinations for foreign investment. As I just said, attracting foreign investment is not just for the capital. It is also for working with multinationals to draw upon their advanced technologies and managerial expertise. But one thing is clear here, that is in the technological cooperation, such cooperation has no prerequisite attached, and there will be no mandatory requirement for technology transfer.
当然，我也听到，啊，有一些外资，啊，负责人，他们对中国在某些领域，进入市场准入，有限制，啊，提出，啊，意见。我可以明确地说，中国，啊，改革开放的时间并不长，我们很多行业，它正在逐渐成熟的过程当中，它的成熟的过程也是逐步扩大开放的过程。中国对外资准入的领域会越来越宽，我们的大门打开了，会越打越大，绝不会关上。
At the same time, I have heard certain complaints from the business leaders of foreign invested companies saying that they still face some restrictions in accessing Chinese market. To them, I want to say that it has not been that long since China launched its reform and opening up program, and some sectors in the Chinese economy have not become mature ones. But this process of them becoming more mature is also a process for them to further open up. And the areas of China's economy open to foreign investment will only increase, and China will only open its door even wider. This door will not close.
在座的各位，只要你们有资金，对中国有投资的愿望，我们热烈的欢迎。具体的项目，我们可以在下面磋商。
For all of you, as long as you have the capital and the interest of making investment in China, you are more than welcome to come to invest in the Chinese market. Specific projects can be discussed later.
Next.
Premier Li, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for having us in your hotel. This is lovely. It truly is an honor, and thank you very much. The United States and China need each other more than ever as the two strongest economies, as quite frankly, the strongest economies. But yet, and you spoke in your speech about mutual respect, and there is no doubt mutual respect, but yet there's so much negativity and even an element of mistrust. You know, you see the press here, and there's articles about currency rate setting or the respect for intellectual property in China. And on my trips to China, I've noticed that the Chinese press even finds negative things to say about the United States, amazingly. But my question truly is, what can we do about this level of mistrust? How can we reduce the level of mistrust, increase the level of cooperation? And in particular, is there anything that frustrates you about misperceptions that America have about your country?
非常感谢总理今天能够在您的国家所拥有的酒店接待我们，当然非常荣幸今天能够有机会向您提问。我认为中美两国都非常需要彼此，中美两国是世界上最强大的经济体，我也赞同您在演讲中提到的相互尊重这个看法，但同时我们也看到我们两国之间也存在着互不信任的问题。我在美国可以看到关于中国人民币汇率还有中国对于知识产权保护和尊重等方面的负面报道。当我去中国的时候，在中国的媒体也看到不少关于美国的负面报道。所以我想问，我们怎么做才能够应对这一互不信任问题，来减少互不信任和加强美中之间的合作？还有就是您对于美国对中国的误解哪一点让您最觉得懊恼？
中美之间啊，的确有误解，也有分歧，但是总的来讲，我们之间的理解远远大于误解和分歧。具体的分歧经常有，譬如刚才你说这是中国国家拥有的酒店。我想做一点纠正，就是这个酒店是中国的一位民营企业家买了他的股权，我听说好像还是由 美国的企业家长期负责经营。
It's true there are misconceptions and differences between our two countries, but I believe the level of mutual understanding and common interests between our two countries far outweighs such misconceptions and differences. And just now you said my hotel, coming to my hotel, but I want to make a correction here for the record. That is, as far as I know, this hotel is for a business leader from a private company in China holding a stake in the hotel, but the hotel still under long-standing management of American businessmen.
So
I'm thinking I'm still staying at an American hotel.
So 媒体相互的报道，我觉得也要全面的看。你如果打开某个媒体，我这里也不想给某个媒体做广告，他对对方国家的报道是多篇的，可能啊很多客观真实的报道读者往往不注意，而有一些挑骨头里面挑刺的报道往往会吸引眼球，这跟读者也有关系。
Well, talking about the mutual media coverage of our each other's countries, I think we need to take a look at the whole picture instead of a partial picture. If you open the news products of a certain media organization here, I don't want to name it, not for advertisement, but I believe you will find the coverage is quite multifaceted. Sometimes truthful and objective coverage may not get people's eye, but nitpicking or sensational stories get people's attention.
当然用鸡蛋挑这个鸡蛋里面挑骨头这个词用的可能重了一些。我觉得呢，媒体记者如果是出于善意做一些批评的报道，对一些对我们互相之间改进我们自己的工作也不无帮助。
Well, using nitpicking here may be a little bit too much. If it is a well-intentioned coverage reporting, even if it is a critical one, I think it should be welcomed because it is good for us to improve what we have been doing.
至于你说到的具体问题，像人民币汇率，这一类的问题，我要解答起来，会用比较长的时间。但是我一句话想说，就是中国的人民币不存在长期贬值的基础，中国也绝不会用贬值的手段来刺激出口，这对中国是没有，中国经济的升级是没有帮助的，没有益处的。
As for the specific topics you alluded to in your question, like currency rate, we wouldn't have that much time for me to dig into the details, but I just want to say that there's not a basis for the continuous devaluation of the Chinese currency, and China has no intention whatsoever to use the devaluation of the Chinese yuan to boost exports, because that is not good for China's economic transformation.
如果你要问到如何增加信任，消除误解，那我觉得还是要多往来。现在中国去年到美国的游客就有260万，在这里的留学生有60万，而据我所知，很多美国人还没有去过中国，他们可能多次去过中美洲的国家。
As for how we can do to boost mutual trust and narrow misconceptions and differences, I think the key lies in closer mutual engagement. As far as I know, last year, Chinese tourists made 2.6 million trips to the United States, and now there are some 600,000 Chinese students studying in the United States. But I also know that for many Americans, maybe they have yet they have not been to China yet. Maybe many of them have been to Central American countries instead.
我对那些希望增加互信人的建议就是我们加强往来。人与人之间的往来，人与人之间的沟通，而且是坦诚的进行。
So I believe the key to deepening our mutual trust lies in close engagement and a larger flow, interflow of personnel between the two countries, so that we can have candid and deep discussions and communication between us to deepen mutual understanding.
Next.
Okay.
Susie, you have Premier Li, over here. Thank you so much for your very refreshing speech and your encouraging words. I'd like to follow up on some of the comments that you have made in answering these questions. Many American business leaders tell me that they are very worried about the current backlash to globalization and global trade that's building here in the US. And I'm sure you've heard the candidates who are running for president here in the States have very harsh words about the loss of American jobs and unfair global trade agreements. Given that China's economic growth really depends on global trade, and you said that there is a mutual interest between our country and China, how concerned are you about this developing trend? What would you say to the presidential candidates in terms of advice? And also to the American public to reassure them that they shouldn't worry about this.
您的演讲和刚才的答问呢，都让我有一种耳目一新而且深受鼓舞的感觉。我在跟许多美国企业界的领袖接触的时候呢，他们告诉我，他们都对现在美国出现的逆全球化和反对世界贸易的这种潮流感到担心。您肯定也听到了美国现在的总统竞选人对于美国丧失就业岗位以及不公平的全球贸易协议所发出的强硬的表态。我也知道中国经济的增长呢，很大程度上是得益于世界贸易的发展。您也谈到了，这对于中美两国是符合我们共同利益的。所以我想问的问题是，您对于这种不断发展的趋势有多担心？那如果要向美国总统候选人提出建议的话，在这个问题上您会对他说什么？以及您会对美国公众说什么来缓解他们对这一趋势的担心？
我这次到联合国参加系列会议，当然应该是到纽约来。之前就有朋友告诉我，你这个时候到美国去的不是时候 ，It's not the right time。
Yes, I'm coming to attend the UN high-level events, but as I'm coming to New York, before I came here, some friends already said to me that they don't think I'm coming to the city at the right time.
因为啊，现在美国大选正在进入白热化的阶段，这是美国的内政，我对此能说的话非常有限。我记得上个世纪八十年代，我曾经访问过美国，我到两党的竞选总部都去访问过。他们问我，都问我，每一个总部的人都问我，你喜欢不喜欢我们的候选人？我只能告诉他一句话，我说不管谁当选，我相信中美关系一定向好。
Because the U.S. presidential election is about to reach a white heat point. This is the United States internal affair. So for me, things that I can say about this topic is very limited. But I recall that in the 1980s, during my visit to the United States, I also went to both headquarters of the two political parties for the presidential campaigns. And at both places, I was asked whether I like the presidential candidates. To both of them, I said that no matter who gets elected, I have confidence in the continued positive growth of China-U.S. relations.
你们让我以中国总理的身份站在这样一个讲台上，我还只能重复我过去说过的一句话：不管大选之后谁任总统，中美关系，我相信一定会稳定向好。
Now you have put me at such a podium, and considering my current capacity, I can only repeat what I said years ago. That is, no matter who gets elected in the U.S. presidential election, I believe that China-U.S. ties will continue to grow steadily and in a positive direction.
但是明天啊，我要参加联合国一般应变论，要发表演讲。我在这个演讲当中，一定是要说全球化的，一定是要说贸易自由化和投资便利化的。请大家一定不要误解，这和美国大选无关。
But tomorrow, I will give a statement at the general debate of the UN General Assembly. In my statement, I will definitely say something about globalization and global trade. But don't misread it as these having anything to do with US presidential election.
在全球化过程当中，某些领域、某些行业、某些人群，确实 有一些负面的影响，但是只有靠全球化、贸易自由化、投资便利化，才能解决这些弊端。我们不能因噎废食。美国是全球化、贸易自由化的继英国之后 最大的受益者，中国现在也是受益者之一。我们愿意和大家共同努力，来维护贸易的自由化，来更加合理的推进全球化。我们也会注意有些人群发出的呼声，我们可以去妥善的处理这些问题。
Globalization may also have some downsides or adverse impact on certain areas, sectors, and groups of people. But I believe that to address these downsides, we can still and we must rely on continued globalization, trade liberalization, and investment facilitation. Just as one does not give up eating for the fear of choking on his food, as the Chinese saying goes. Following the United Kingdom, the United States has been the biggest beneficiary from globalization, and China is also a big beneficiary from this trend. So we want to work with all other parties in the global community. One of the big beneficiaries from globalization. So China wants to work with all members of the international community to continue to advance trade liberalization and advance globalization as appropriate. But in the meantime, we should also pay high attention to the calls and aspiration of relevant groups of people and see to it their concerns will be properly addressed. But all in all, I believe the world's trend will continue to move forward.
中文是联合国的官方语言，所以我用中文发言。
I hope you will understand, as Chinese is one of the official languages of the UN, so I should speak in Chinese here.
、Premier Li, first let me thank you very much for your very thoughtful and very comprehensive speech. You honor us by your presence tonight and by your leadership and your vision. I would like to follow up one of the points that you made in your speech and in the question and answer session on the trading system. As you correctly pointed out, global trade has been declining over the last several years. You also pointed out how interdependent our two countries and many others are on the global trading system. One of the concerns now, in addition to the decline in global trade, is that in many countries throughout the world, we see increased economic nationalism, we see domestic pressures for localization, we see various groups who want to pull back from the global trading system rather than take the lead in improving the global trading system. Those pressures occur in the United States, in China, and many other countries. But you also make the fundamental point that we need a global trading system. We need an open and thriving global system. So my question is, what can China and the U.S. do together to reverse this deterioration in support for the global trading system to make sure that it thrives and becomes more open rather than less open? And in particular, are there opportunities for the United States and China through the negotiation of the bilateral investment treaty to take the lead together in strengthening international rules, strengthening the rules, improving the opportunities for global investment, which will stimulate growth and stimulate additional trade?
您总理刚才您的演讲既全面又思想深刻，而且我也非常赞赏您在演讲和答问中展现出来的远见卓识和领导力。我的问题呢，也是跟全球贸易有关的。我想您在演讲当中呢，也已经一针见血地指出，近几年呢，全球贸易增长十分乏力。同时，我也非常赞同您说的，我们两国之间以及世界许多其他国家在全球贸易的体系下呢，相互依存度都是很高的。 但同时，我们也有这样的一种担忧，就是在许多国家出现了经济民族主义抬头的这种趋势，而且国内面临巨大压力，要使生产本地化。还有人呢，希望逆全球贸易体系而动，而不是进一步改善全球贸易体系。在美国，在中国，在世界许多国家，可能都有这种趋势发展的一些迹象。 所以我想提问您的问题呢，就是美中两国能够一起做什么，使扭转这种减少对世界贸易体系支持的这种趋势，而共同努力加强全球贸易体系，使它变得更为开放，而不是相反。 还有呢，就是美中两国如何抓住通过BIT 谈判所带来的机遇，共同发挥领导作用，来增强全球贸易的国际规则，创造更多可以刺激国际世界经济增长和繁荣的机会。我觉得美中两国应该共同向世界发声。
我们都支持国际现行贸易体系的安排，支持在 WTO 框架下推进贸易自由化和投资的便利化。中美两国和其他国家一起在国际上发声，会有利于。 避免利权球化的进程出现，也有利于避免贸易壁垒以邻为壑的现象屡屡发生，其结果殃及的是世界经济复苏的大局。
I believe China and the United States should send a common message to the international community. Both of our two countries are strong supporters of the existing global trading regime, and we both believe that we need to advance trade liberalization and investment facilitation under the WTO framework. So China and the U.S. should work together with all other countries in the world to send out a strong and concerted message, and I believe this will help prevent the anti-globalization trend from further evolving and help prevent the trade barriers and a beggar thy neighbor approach from emerging, because the anti-globalization trade or the approach that I just mentioned are not good for the enhancement of global economic recovery.
其实中美两国应该进一步扩大相互的开放，不仅是贸易，包括投资。我们正在进行的BIT谈判，实际上是给中美工商界都发出了一个积极的信号。中方尽最大努力，已经在这两年内三次改进了报价，现在正在进行第29轮中美BIT的谈判。 我们需要的是美方做出反应了。我觉得我们之间只要采取务实、灵活的态度，是可以达成一个高水平的、互利共赢的 BIT。
Well, secondly, I believe our two countries need to further open up to each other in both trade and mutual investment. Now China and the United States are engaged in the BIT negotiation. The negotiation in itself has sent out a positive message to the business communities of both countries. China has exerted strong efforts in this respect and in just 2 years put forward revised offers for 3 times. And now the two countries are engaged in the 29th round of BIT negotiation. We are now waiting for a response from the U.S. side. I believe that as long as both sides take a pragmatic and flexible approach, we will be able to arrive at a high standard and mutually beneficial BIT.
你的问题也提醒我，在这个场合可以讲两件事儿，来表明啊中方对美扩大开放的诚意，就是我们最近已经完成了对美国 带骨舒华牛肉的检疫，我们很快会确定从美国进口带骨牛肉。中国是一个农产品大国，也是个畜牧生产大国，但是美国有好的牛肉，我们为什么不让中国的消费者给他们更多的选择的权利？
Well, your question reminds me that there are two things that I can share with you here, showing Chinese sincerity about opening up its market to the United States. One is China's domestic governmental authorities have completed the quarantine procedures for imports of U.S. beef with bone, and we will soon have such imports of beef from the United States. Well, China itself is a large producer of agricultural products and in animal husbandry, but we also recognize that the United States has very good beef. So why should we deny Chinese customers this good choice?
Thank you. 如果我要是在美国的中西部宣布这个消息的话，
我得到的掌声会更热烈。I'm sure there will be louder applause if I say it in Midwest United States. In Midwest United States.
但是这是在纽约，我还想说一家，我们已经决定在纽约设立一家人民币的清算行，而且欢迎纽约有条件的银行设立人民币清算行，这样会有利于我们之间 更顺利的跨境贸易。
One more thing, as I'm in New York, I want to say that we have decided to designate a Chinese invested bank as a clearing bank for RMB business in New York. And we also welcome those foreign banks in New York who meet the eligibility requirements to become clearing banks for Chinese RMB business. I'm sure that will only further boost our engagement.
主席先生希望我现在欣赏一下美国的牛肉，我的讲话到此为止。
Well, it seems that Mr. President wants me to have the chance to taste U.S. beef during our dinner, exactly. So maybe I'll wrap up my remarks.
Thank you, Premier Li. Thank you. And thank you to our questioners as well. And you're about to be able to taste some U.S. beef, but before, we just have some brief remarks. Which will lead to a toast for this evening. And for that, I'd like to introduce Carla Hills, who's chair of the National Committee of U.S.-China Relations and who was Secretary of Housing and Urban Development under President Gerald Ford and U.S. Trade Representative under President George H.W. Bush. And she will be joined by Economic Club New York Chair Emerita Barbara Franklin, who recently served currently serves on the boards of both the U.S.-China Business Council and the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations, and was Secretary of Commerce under President George H.W. Bush. Carla and Barbara, please take the podium.
Thank you. Well, good evening, one and all. I must say that as chair of the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations, one of my most enjoyable assignments is to welcome visiting Chinese leaders who come to the United States. And so I really want to extend the warmest welcome to Premier Li, and also to extend our deepest appreciation for your making the time to be with us tonight. The National Committee is delighted to join the Economic Club of New York and the U.S.-China Business Council for this evening's celebratory dinner. This year, the National Committee is celebrating its 50th anniversary. And since hosting the ping pong exchange in the 1960s, the committee has been absolutely dedicated to strengthening Sino-American relations. Your remarks, Premier Li, and your wonderful answers to the four questions have given us an excellent overview to your government's thinking on a range of critical policy issues. This year, the UN General Assembly is focused on sustainable development, and we strongly at the National Committee applaud the fact that China and the United States, the world's two largest economies, have formally committed to the Paris Climate Agreement. The world will be a better and safer place as a result of our collaboration. This partnership is an outstanding example of the good that can come, not only to our two nations, but to the world at large when we work together. And your meeting yesterday with President Obama is continued evidence of our joint dedication to find sound solutions to tough problems. And we look forward to much more collaboration in the days, the weeks, and the months ahead. Now let me turn to my very good friend, Secretary Barbara Franklin, to say a few words.
Well, thank you, and good evening, everyone. I'm here tonight with my U.S.-China Business Council hat on, although I wear several different hats. I'm a longstanding board member, and of course the council is one of the co-hosts for this evening's event to honor Premier Li. And we are really delighted that our three organizations could come together this way and honor Premier Li. We are thrilled that you are here. I want to add my thanks and those of the U.S.-China Business Council to Premier Li for his wide-ranging remarks and his candid answers to the questions, particularly the question about our politics. Appreciated that answer very much. Trade and investment. And again, I'm very pleased, Premier, with the way you have addressed the need to continue to build trade around the world. But trade and investment are the very foundation of stable relations between the United States and China. And with the global economy facing numerous challenges, it's more important than ever that the two of our countries be sources of economic stability. We must continue to strengthen cooperation, reduce our differences, and increase confidence and friendship. I'm optimistic that the United States and China will continue to find ways to work together for our common good as well as for the common good of the entire global community. And I want to echo what my friend Carla said. We are honored that you took time from this very busy United Nations General Assembly schedule to come and talk with this large and distinguished audience, and we thank you. And now, a toast. Will you, Carla and I, ask you all to raise your glasses and join us. Premier Li, on behalf of the U.S.-China Business Council, the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations, and the Economic Club of New York, our best to you, to your health, to a successful visit, and to mutually beneficial relations between China and the United States. Ganbei.
Ganbei.
Well done.
Okay.
Well done.
Okay. Good work. I brought my champagne up, so now I have quite a few.
I am to also tell you to now please enjoy your dinner and your table companions. And just before the Premier must leave, Chairman Lundgren will take the podium again and give us our instructions. And I'm sure we'll thank Premier Li Keqiang once more and thank all of you for coming. Okay.